think of the biggest questions that humanity has ever asked, right? What comes to mind? Is it maybe, you know, what's the meaning of life? Why are we all here? Or perhaps even, how did all of this start? And thanks to physics, we've actually been able to answer one of those questions. It's not the answer to the meaning of life, unfortunately.
42.
But instead, it's the question that I reckon is the biggest that humanity has ever asked, right? It's at the root of the existence of every single thing around us. And it's, how did the universe begin? So most cultures around the world have some sort of story explaining the origin of the universe. And usually those stories involve a creator or a deity of some kind. So for example, you know, ancient Greeks with Gaia, Chinese mythology with Pangu, and then also, you know, modern day Judeo-Christian mythology with their god that created the world in 7 days. Now, because this religious mythology was so ingrained in society, you know, early philosophers didn't really ask the question of how the universe began. They more focused on sort of the structure and the scale of the universe around them, since, you know, their mythology had already answered that question of how the universe began for them. And the agreed upon structure went through, you know, many variations over the millennia, from a stationary Earth with celestial spheres of the stars rotating above it, to a rotating Earth in the center of the universe, to the 1500s, where the likes of Copernicus and Galileo and Bruno shifted the scientific worldview to say that, you know, observations of the sky could really only be explained if the sun was at the center of the solar system. And then they hypothesized that the solar system was surrounded by this static, i.e. unchanging, and infinite universe that was filled fairly uniformly with stars in all directions. Now, as we heard in the last episode of this series on sort of the great debate on the scale of the universe, observations of the stars in the Milky Way itself shifted the sun from sort of the center of everything to sort of on the outskirts of our galaxy of stars, the Milky Way, and showed us that the Milky Way was also not sort of everything in the universe. It was sort of just an island of stars, and there was many other islands of stars that we call galaxies out there in the universe. But despite that shift in sort of our position in the universe and the actual scale of the universe as well, this idea of a static universe still hung around. And a lot of people thought the universe was indeed static, including Albert Einstein himself. Now, in 1917, Einstein published his theory of general relativity. It describes how gravity works as a property of space and time. He said the way that gravity could be described is that objects with mass curve space-time. The bigger the object, the more that space gets curved, and therefore the objects traveling along it are now traveling along a curved surface that's no longer flat, and those are the effects of gravity that we see. What Einstein realized, though, is that general relativity didn't just, you know, describe the behavior of things like individual objects like the sun and Mercury. It could also be applied to the entire universe. So you could get sort of a mathematical model of the universe. But what he realized was that sort of masses and objects in the universe that would just bend this space-time, they would actually be attracted to each other under gravity over time. And so therefore the universe would change and wouldn't be static. He managed to find sort of a solution to his equations for a universe with a finite size that was static and unchanging if he introduced a constant into his equations that essentially acted against gravity all the time, keeping his universe nice and static. Thing was, though, if there was any tiny fluctuations in the properties of the universe, that would cause Einstein's model universe to either expand or to contract. It was sort of one of these just-so theories. Now, other physicists, such as Friedman, realized in the 1920s that Einstein's model universe that he'd derived was actually just one very specific solution to Einstein's sort of overarching equations of general relativity. And actually, if you sort of worked it through to get sort of a less specific answer, that actually an expanding or a contracting universe was actually much more likely than Einstein's static one. So these solutions to Einstein's general relativity equations were called the cosmological solutions. This really was the birth of modern cosmology. Cosmology being a branch of astrophysics that's concerned with understanding the origins and the evolution of the universe. So here, for the very first time, there were actually equations and models to describe the universe that we could actually test against observations that we would make and test with the scientific process. So in 1927, Georges Lemaître was working through the equations to get one of these cosmological solutions to general relativity. And once again, he found that this universe model that he derived could either expand or contract. Now, at this point in 1927, the spiral nebula that Harlow and Shapley were arguing about in our previous episode on the great debate on the size of the universe had shown to be islands of stars in themselves. They've been shown to be galaxies just like the Milky Way. And crucially, they've been shown to have a redshift or a Doppler shift that meant that they were moving away from us. Lemaître interpreted this moving away of galaxies from us as expansion of the universe, like suggested by his equations, his cosmological solution to general relativity. But in 1931, he took it one step further and he proposed the first sort of scientifically motivated hypothesis for the origin of the universe. He said that if you could rewind time in this expanding universe, then the further back in time you go, the smaller the universe will be, until you reach a point where the universe is all contained in a single point. And so he said the universe must have started in what he called a cosmic egg explosion outwards, from which the universe has been expanding ever since. But Lemaître's cosmic egg explosion idea wasn't really that popular at the time. That was mainly because when physicists sort of took the rate of expansion that was measured and thought about that idea of rewinding time to get at sort of how long the universe has been expanding for, and therefore how old is it, the age they got was less than the sort of measured age for the age of the solar system. So it was sort of dismissed very quickly, and through the 30s and 40s, more and more hypotheses were raised to explain this apparent expansion of the universe, including Fritz Zwicky's sort of tired light idea. But then obviously World War II hit and physicists were, well, occupied for a good number of years after that. So this wasn't really picked up on again until the late 1940s, when George Gamow used the equations that had been developed to carry out the calculations to determine, you know, what would happen to atoms in a nuclear bomb explosion, to work out, well, what atoms would be formed if you started from a point of infinite density and infinite pressure, like what Lemaître had suggested the universe started out in this sort of cosmic egg. Now, Gamow managed to show that out of such conditions, you could barely make anything heavier than hydrogen or helium. And so at first he thought, well, the cosmic egg idea of Lemaître couldn't therefore be any good because, you know, around us all right now are obviously much heavier elements, you know, lots of carbon and iron and oxygen and nitrogen that we breathe. But then work by Fred Hoyle and many others in the same decade had showed very compelling evidence for the fact that stars and supernova were actually the ones that produced the very heavy elements from the starting point of just hydrogen. So Gamow set his PhD student at the time, Ralph Alford, the task of solving these equations again, but under the assumption that anything heavier than lithium would be formed by stars and by supernova. And they found that the proportion of hydrogen and helium found in the early universe could actually be correctly predicted by this model that starts out with the infinite density and pressure in this sort of cosmic egg beginnings of the universe. This work that they published is a very famous paper. It's the Alpha Beta Gamma paper. They added their colleague Beta, despite him doing very little work for the paper, just so they could have a pun on Alpha Beta Gamma, the first three letters of the Greek alphabet. And to be honest, it worked because everybody remembers it as the Alpha Beta Gamma paper. And it's a very famous result. Now, Alpha went on to do more work on this idea of the cosmic egg hypothesis, working with Robert Herman. And together they predicted that if this cosmic egg explosion had happened, there should be sort of a relic energy or radiation left over in the universe that was sort of an echo of those beginnings. The thing is, what they predicted with their model is that that radiation, although it would have been incredibly energetic at the very beginning of the universe, it would have been redshifted and the wavelength stretched out so much by this point that it probably would be in the region of microwaves or radio waves now. And that wasn't something that people thought was possible at the time to do. And so Alpha and Hermann's work really did fall into obscurity for the next couple of decades, but you guys should remember it for later. But Lemaître's cosmic egg idea wasn't the only hypothesis that was being considered at the time. In particular, Fred Hoyle, of his, you know, heavier elements are made in stars and supernova fame, really didn't like this idea. So in 1948, Hoyle worked with Thomas Gold and Henry Bondi to formulate what they called the steady state theory. They argued that the universe was static, i.e. it was unchanging, and also that it was eternal, i.e. it didn't have a beginning or even an end. But they still had to explain this apparent sort of movement of the galaxies away from us. This would have been interpreted as expansion. And so they said that as space expands and galaxies move away from each other, new matter is created spontaneously to fill that gap, and a new galaxy is made in the space that has been created. You can think of this as kind of like how a river flows, right? The river always looks the same, but it's always new water molecules that are streaming in behind it to keep it looking the same. Now, this was very, very different from Lemaître's cosmic egg hypothesis. And Fred Hoyle was a big scientific communicator as well as researcher. He's sort of one of a hero of mine. And he actually was sort of on BBC radio describing these two theories to the public, same as I'm doing here. And he used the term Big Bang for Lemaître's cosmic egg idea. And it was really just to highlight the differences between the two theories. It wasn't really a slur against the theory like a lot of people report. But the term still stuck, Big Bang, right? We use that term today to describe Lemaître's cosmic egg, as he called it, as a Big Bang. Now, having said that, Hoyle supposedly intensely disliked the Big Bang theory idea. He called it pseudoscience. He thought that most Western scientists were driven to sort of supporting the idea of the Big Bang theory because they wanted to find a scientific theory that was in support of the creation story in Genesis. And in fact, this debate between sort of the Big Bang theory and steady state theory was waded into by both religion and politics. So in 1952, Pope Pius XII announced that the Big Bang theory was actually consistent with the idea of an overarching creator or God, like in Christian mythology, whereas steady state theory was seen as more of an atheist view. Gamow, meanwhile, was arguing that the steady state theory was aligned with communist ideologies, despite the fact that, you know, Soviet astronomers at the time had dismissed both the Big Bang theory and the steady state theory, whereas Hoyle was very much of the opinion that steady state was anti-communist, sort of in that idea of individual freedom. And I think this just shows the importance of not politicizing or religiosicizing, if that is a word, you know, scientific debate, because it introduces this implicit human bias that doesn't allow for rational thought or logical thinking or the scientific process. I'm sure with what I've just said, you now feel some odd connection to either the Big Bang theory or steady state theory because of your political or religious views. What you really need, though, are scientific tests of each theory, right? And evidence in favor of either one or the other. And this is what Fred Hoyle said was lacking for the Big Bang theory. If there had indeed been this Big Bang, there should be some sort of fossil record, as he put it, or an echo of this Big Bang happening. Now, little did Fred Hoyle realize that this evidence in favor of the Big Bang would start piling up over the next decade or two. Walter Bade solved the first problem in 1952. Remember that really embarrassing result that the age of the universe you got from extrapolating back from the expansion rate in the Big Bang theory was younger than the known age of the solar system at the time? Well, it turns out there are two types of Cepheid variable stars. Cepheid variable stars are these standard candles that astronomers use to measure distances to very distant objects in the universe. And once you've measured the distance to that object and you've measured how fast it's moving away from you, you can then get at the expansion rate. Now, with two types of Cepheid variable stars, it means that half the time you underestimate the distance to that object by a half, and therefore you overestimate the rate of expansion by two. Once that was taken into account, the age of the universe then what became older than the known age of the solar system, and that embarrassing problem was solved. But the most compelling evidence for the Big Bang Theory came once again out of technology developed for World War II. This time it was radio technology, so things like radar and the ability to detect very faint radio signals that had travelled long distances. So after the war, instead of using those antenna to detect radio signals that were being transferred on Earth, astronomers started pointing those antenna at the sky and started setting up radio observatories everywhere from Manchester to Cambridge to Sydney in Australia, all to observe the sky in long wavelengths such as radio and microwaves. Now, the observatory in Cambridge was set up by Martin Ryle, who in 1974 actually went on to win a Nobel Prize just for his sort of general contributions to radio astronomy. But in 1955, he just completed sort of a survey of the radio sky and had found 2,000 objects that were emitting radio waves. And he was very curious about their distribution in the universe, not just their distribution on the sky, which he observed was sort of fairly random in all directions, but their distribution in terms of like their 3D distribution in the universe. And so what he assumed was that the fainter sources that he detected were further away. And so by just that simple assumption, he could then work out, you know, whether radio sources were more common sort of in the very local universe, sort of now-ish, or whether they were more common in the distant universe, which, because light takes time to get to us, is also the earlier universe. And what he found was that even despite the fact that, you know, you're working with different volumes, the radio sources were so much denser at greater distances, which means that objects that emit radio waves were more common earlier in the universe or a longer time ago. That's massively against what steady state theory says. Steady state theory says the universe is not evolving, it's unchanging. And yet here was evidence that somehow the universe had evolved from a time when objects emitting radio waves was much more common than it is today. Now, Ryle supposedly overestimated the significance of his results at the time. When people go back and look at his numbers, it's a bit like, really? Did you find that? But actually, Ryle went on to then discover quasars in our universe as well, which were incredibly bright radio and even X-ray sources too, which eventually, after the Hubble Space Telescope was launched back in the 90s, we discovered an optical counterpart for. You could then actually get the distances to these things to actually say whether, you know, galaxies or quasars at greater distances were actually more common in emitting their radio waves back then, and confirmed actually that yes, the universe is evolving as we actually observe it. It is different at greater distances when the universe was much younger. The ultimate blow to steady state theory though came in 1963 from Arno Penzias and Robert Wilson. They were hired by Bell Laboratories to build the most sensitive radio and microwave telescope they possibly could. But after they switched it on, they kept just detecting this strange, like a hiss, like a background noise, almost sort of like a snow kind of thing on your TV, right? On old TVs anyway. And they couldn't explain what it was. It was coming from all directions. So at first they thought it was sort of terrestrial in origin, right? It was coming from Earth. So their first idea was that it was from sort of like the nearby-ish, very densely populated New York City. It was sort of this background noise of radio. But they couldn't prove that hypothesis at all. Then they discovered that on the antenna that they were using to detect these radio waves, it was just covered in just bat and bird droppings, right? It was just covered in pigeon poo. And they thought, oh, maybe that's why we have this sort of background noise and hiss in our observations. And so they cleaned off all the pigeon poo, and then lo and behold, this background hiss is still there. Out of ideas, they then contacted Robert Dicke, a well-known astronomer and cosmologist who had developed, during World War II, the type of antenna Penzias and Wilson were actually using. Now, Dicke had also been using one of his radio antennae that he'd developed to try and detect something that him and his PhD student at the time, Jim Peebles, who actually won the Nobel Prize in Physics last year in 2019. I did a video on that. I'll link it somewhere if you're interested to find out what else he did for the field. And they had predicted that if the Big Bang Theory was true, there should be this echo of radiation that had started off as very energetic gamma rays and had been redshifted to longer wavelengths until it's reached the radio or microwave sort of wavelength range, and they were trying to detect it. Now, obviously, Alpha and Hermann had also predicted this back in the 40s, but like I said, it had fallen into obscurity. Peebles and Dick weren't aware of that work at the time, so sort of independently predicted this and then gone looking for it. And so when Panzias and Wilson then came to this, they realized that they had been sort of scooped to the detection of this radiation, this background radiation that should be permeating, you know, the whole universe. But obviously Panzias and Wilson didn't know what it was that they had detected. And so it was really great. They actually published simultaneously with Panzias and Wilson announcing the discovery of what they'd found, with Dick and Peebles actually explaining the significance of what it actually meant and showing that it was indeed this sort of fossil record of the Big Bang. Now, background radiation is now known today as the cosmic microwave background, and it really was considered sort of the death blow to the steady state theory. And it was at that point really that the scientific community readily accepted this idea of the Big Bang, that the universe had started from this, you know, infinitely small point of infinite density and pressure and temperature that we call a singularity. Into the 60s, the likes of Roger Penrose, Stephen Hawking, George Ellis showed that these points of infinite density and pressure that we call these singularities that, you know, we see at the beginning of the universe and also, you know, describe black holes with, they're actually inevitable in nature. And that, I think, really removed sort of the last shadow of a doubt that physicists had over this idea of, like, this, you know, really possible to have everything reeled back into this infinitely small point. And from there on in, it's been, you know, very much working out the finer details, very precise observations, really resolving the cosmic microwave background in much more detail and sort of thinking about what that can tell us about how the universe has actually evolved. Now, even with all this evidence in favor of the Big Bang theory and the sort of successes of modern cosmology and explaining so many things in our universe, Hoyle still argued in favor of the steady state theory right up until his death in 2001, even despite the fact that his work on sort of the fact that heavier elements are made in stars and supernova sort of forms one of the cornerstones of the Big Bang theory. Now, one of the things that physicists still struggle with to this day, and the thing that we can't explain, is this idea of the creation of something out of nothing, right? This creation of energy. That's one sort of main law of physics, right? Is that energy cannot be created or destroyed, and therefore matter cannot be created or destroyed. It can only be converted from one form to the other, right? Like me converting kinetic energy, you know, from food that I have eaten, you know, and burnt into kinetic energy, into sound energy by just clapping, right? Like that's a conversion of energy. But both the Big Bang theory and the steady state theory suffer from this, you know, inability to explain how this creation happened, right? The Big Bang theory, in a single sort of moment of creation where all energy and matter in the universe is created all at once, where the steady state theory, where it's sort of at a much slower rate, this creation of matter. Another thing is that, you know, our models of the universe can be pushed back and back and back right to the very beginning, except in the very first 0.0 and then 42 more noughts and then 1 seconds of the universe. At that point, temperatures, pressures, densities get so large that all our models and our laws of physics and our equations just break down, including general relativity. So they just cannot be tested in any way because we just don't have the physics to explain it. So despite the fact that, you know, this debate between the idea of the Big Bang theory or the steady state theory, whether the universe began in a moment of creation or whether it's sort of always been eternal, despite the fact that that debate has been considered settled by the scientific community since the 60s, I am happy to report that there is still so much more work to be done. Two things before we get to the bloopers. The first one is that the German translation of my book is now available for all of you German speakers out there. I've put the link in the description below. The second thing is that I want to thank this week's sponsor, which is brilliant. It is a website chock full of courses on science, maths, and computing, which get you to learn by doing and not just by watching YouTube videos. So if you want to get into more of the nitty-gritty details on cosmology after watching this video, then never fear, because Brilliant has you covered, from the basics on what we mean by a homogeneous or an isotropic or a static universe, to the detail on the cosmic microwave background that was, you know, the death blow to the steady state theory that we talked about in this video. The courses are interactive, breaking down problems bit by bit into easier chunks, eventually teaching you to think logically like a scientist. If that sounds like it's up your street, then get yourself over to brilliant.org/Dr. Becky. That's DrBecky, and start your free trial today. Also, the first 200 people that go to that link will get 20% off an annual premium subscription. So thank you so much to Brilliant for that. And now all that's left is for editing Becky to roll those bloopers. Extra term into his equations that was this constant term that always counteracted. He thought that people preferred this theory because they were motivated. That was a terrible Australian accent. I apologize to all Australians out there. Of infinite temperature and infinite pressure and the whole universe was in a hot, dense state, and then 14 billion years ago, expansion started. Wait. The whole universe is in a steady state, and then matter is born in the space where expansion started. Wait. I'll work on it.